Famcast Media. Bitch.
We're heading towards Copenhagen, Denmark. We're recording Ride the Lightning, which is the second album. At Sweet Silence Studio, where some early Merciful Fate demos have been recorded. The two latest Rainbow albums have been recorded there. It's a real good sound, real good in-house engineer. And it's gonna sound, more ballsy than Kill 'Em All. It's gonna have, more rougher, Because Kill 'Em All was a bit too polished. There's songs, Fight Fire with Fire, Fast.
We saw the new wave of British metal that was coming out. We knew it was going to hit a couple of years before. It was going to hit the States fairly soon. So, we liked doing it. And we were doing it down in LA, and a lot of people didn't know what the hell was going on. So we didn't see any hairdos or makeup or anything. Just going up there bashing it. The basic principles are the same as they were, 5 years ago when we were starting out. The rock is on a bit higher level, like I said, But still the same four idiots, trying to stay in tune and stay on time.
We do what we want to do, If they consider that selling out, then whatever.
A lot of people think you sold out just because you're on a major label and are very popular.
Or maybe you don't play 1,000 miles an hour the whole time,
We're not trying to be something big and fancy, It's just us doing what we do. Let's keep it that way.
Welcome to the Sinkin' Wang Show, man. We are so glad you're with us. We have something different for you. We're not going to do a Kiss album. We're going to do a Kiss album next episode. And we just want to say this is going to be brutally awesome and everything. And let me just say something, man. For all the people outside of the United States of America, where me and Sinkin' Stanley are based and born, if you're all looking at what's going on in the United States of America the last 8 days, and if you're wondering what the fuck's going on, here's what's going on. It's a motherfucking clusterfuck. Bam! Hey! Anyways, here, I want to introduce the biggest troll on the planet, Paul Stanley's worst enemy, Sinkin' Stanley! Bam!
Sinkin' Stanley here, people, and listen, if you don't know who to vote for, just vote for Gene Simmons. He just announced his 2024 presidential candidacy. So Gene Simmons will be on the ballot this year. What do you think of that, Wang?
I don't know what to think of it, man. You know what? Before that video was invented, this is what I think about everything. We are fucked.
No, man. <We're> fucked. Green Simmons going to take care of everything.
Yeah, right. Just like the last guy and the current guy took care of everything. Again, we're fucked.
He's going to put it all in his back pocket.
Oh, I bet he is. I bet he is. My brother.
Yo, so, Wang, what are we going to talk about this week?
Well, what we're going to talk about this week is an album that came out July 27th, 1984, produced by Flemming Rasmussen, recorded at Sweet Silent Studios in Copenhagen, Denmark. Probably, if I'm being honest, despite the haters, I would say this album and Master of Puppets are the two greatest thrash metal albums ever. Some years I've picked Ride the Lightning. Some years I've picked Master of Puppets. I really don't know. It's very close. It's very, very close. And the beautiful thing about this era of Metallica, I was fortunate enough to see them with Cliff Burton. I saw Metallica with Cliff Burton. I've said this on past episodes three times. The first time was August 31st, 1985, with my lovable Chubby and lovable Derek Rooney. And then on New Year's Eve,
Was that Day on the Green?
Yes, it was Day on the Green. Yes, sir.
The Day on the Green was the first time.
Yeah, correct. August 31st.
Continue.
Yeah, August 31st, 1985, Day on the Green. Back in the day, there was this huge, you know, thing, all sorts of different shit. And on that specific day, on that Saturday, August 31st, 1985, it was headlined by the Scorpions. Obviously, they were on top of the world with Love at First Sting. The second band was Rat. They were on top of the world with Invasion of Your Privacy in 85, wow. and then the previous year, Out of the Cellar. And then, interestingly enough, YNT was third on the bill, a band that I love.
That must have been like their Summertime Girls era.
Yeah, unfortunately, Down for the Count, I believe. Yeah, Down for the Count. I think that did him dirty.
They bring their big robot out on stage?
That's a great question. I don't think so. Maybe they did. I don't know, man. I mean, and then fourth on the bill with a little band called Metallica, and they were on obviously still the Ride the Lightning tour, our album that we're reviewing, and Yngwie J. Malmsteen was fifth on the bill, and then some nobody.
What album? What album was that? What album with Yngwie?
Let's see. Wouldn't there still been Rising Force?
Maybe. Yeah, I guess so.
Yeah, because Trilogy was 86.
Yes, it would be.
Was 86.
Or was it Marching Out?
Oh, man. You know, obviously, we're a professional podcast, and I obviously did not do professional research. I think you're going to ask any questions about Yngwie J. Malmsteen.
I think it might have been Marching Out, man.
Okay, all right. So Rising Force.
Whatever. Who else was on there?
Yeah, that's about it. And a nobody band called Victory. And then I saw Metallica on December 31st, 1985, and technically January 1st, 1986. It was at the San Francisco Civic Center. I saw Kiss Creatures of the Night tour two and a half years prior. And of course, I was still with Chubby. And that was Metallica, Megadeth. Wow. Opened. It was the first in, I mean, I don't know, Pat. I think they shared the stage numerous occasions, but that was the first after the whole, you know, kicking them out and everything. Was the first time Megadeth was on the same bill as Metallica.
Dave was still pissed at him by then.
Oh, hell, are you kidding me?
He probably came out with all kinds of piss and vinegar.
Yeah. I'm not going to sit here and claim his whole disseration. I don't remember what he said. I do remember what he said in 1988 in Oakland, but that's another story altogether. But anyway, so it was Metallica, Exodus, Metal Church, and Megadeth. I believe.
Holy Megadeth, shit!
Yeah. I believe it went. Yeah, I believe in order it went. Metallica, Megadeth, Exodus, Metal Church. So.
Wow. Yeah. Megadeth, yeah. Killing Is My Business, right? Their first album.
Correct. Yeah. Before Peace Sells, It was before Master Puppets came out. Matter of fact, they were all drinking Heineken. They were all drinking Heineken. It was so cool, crazy that each band member. So at midnight, they came out, celebration in 1986, New Year, Dilly D. And then James comes up to the mic and says, "We're going to play it." And it's the first time it was ever played ever. They played a couple nights prior in Sacramento, which is interesting. They actually opened up for YNT in Sacramento. I believe, don't quote me, I believe it was December 27th, 1985. But lo and behold, yeah, they opened up for YNT. So then they came to their home ground, San Francisco Civic Center. Place holds, which it still exists, I'd say 7,500. But it was amazing, man. It was so amazing. And then he comes off the mic and says, "We're going to play a song from our new album. This song is called Master of Puppets." It's like, bam!
Oh, wow.
Yeah. It was just so fucking amazing, dude. So, yeah. So, anyways, man, sing it daily, man. Get into the first song. What's your take on?
No. Let's hang on a minute. We got a couple little more facts on this. Ride the Lightning was originally released still on Megaforce Records, and They were 2 months into the release, and they got picked up by Elektra. They got picked up by a major label, and they bought Metallica, and they reissued Ride the Lightning under the Elektra label. So that was pretty cool.
Good knowledge, brother, man. Keep going. Spit out wax, brother. Back.
And then, like you said, you know, they went to Copenhagen and recorded their album because Lars liked, a couple albums, you know, that the guy did, like, for Rainbow and stuff. But they rehearsed in Merciful Fate's rehearsal studio.
Right. I saw that.
That became a lifelong friendship. And we all know that Metallica recorded that Merciful Fate medley and had Merciful Fate come up and perform with them at one of their big shows. And
it was the 30th. Anniversary in 2011.
Yes, sir.
Eight blocks west from where I am right here at Wang Tower.
That's awesome.
At the Fillmore Auditorium. Yeah, unfortunately, I was not there.
And that was awesome, man, because they did all that and they had all their previous members come up, even Dave Mustaine. Classy as fuck. Metallica are class act. They're very loyal to you and they do shit right, man. They just treat everybody in their camp right, man.
And Lars was 100% correct on Napster.
Absolutely. Oh my God, he was beyond correct.
Beyond the realm. Correct. Yeah, exactly, dude.
Oh my God, man. Napster done killed the music industry. Look where we are now.
Exactly.
And
before you get into the first song, if it wasn't for Chubby, I would not know who. Maybe eventually I would have found out. But Chubby was the first person that fucking turned me on to Metallica. It was late 84. Obviously, the album came out July 27th. This is probably November of 84. The heaviest shit I was into was Maiden, you know, like Power Slave. And then 84, Priest, Defenders of the Faith. You know what I'm saying? Sabotage. But when I heard, when Chubby said, "Hold on a minute, I'll draw my Volkswagen Scirocco," Chubby had this cassette tape.
Chubby rules.
Yeah, Chubby is an icon, and we all love him and everything. And hopefully he'll run for president. I'll remember it. No, seriously, I had a Blaupunkt stereo. All Sciroccos had Blaupunkts. And he said, "Play this, dude." And he put in Ride the Lightning. And that was the beginning. Yeah. And I was like, and on the real, I'm not going to be fucking disingenuous. At first, same thing I had with Pantera 10 years later or whatever. Not 10 years later, 5 years later. I remember at first going, holy shit, this is like so heavy, my brain can't really comprehend it. So it took me a while because, you know, I wasn't, you know, I mean, I sure I was into the Clash and the Sex Pistols as far as punk and everything goes, but that heavy of it was,
yeah,
it was so fucking heavy, man.
That's what people can't comprehend now. Is when Metallica first came out.
Yeah, I was still a teenager, so I hadn't experienced, you know, life. Yeah. So I got, holy fuck, I thought fucking Free Will Burning was fucking heavy. Holy fuck.
Exactly, exactly.
You know, yeah, so amazing, so brilliant, but I have to fucking give 100% chops to Chubby, Chubby, Chubby. Bam!
Well, man, I got into Metallica. To be honest with you, I can't remember who introduced me to Metallica. All I know is I went to the mall and I heard about Metallica and how badass they were. So I bought this little EP called Whiplash. And that was in 83. I picked that up at Camelot Music, brought that home, put that on the turntable. And I was like, holy shit, man, Whiplash, Seek and Destroy, Phantom Lord live. I was like, this is the shit, man. And then shortly after that, you know, a buddy in school had the Ride the Lightning cassette, and he said, take this home and listen to this, man, if you like Metallica. I'm like, okay. So I brought that home. I was just like, oh, shit, Ride the Lightning. It's been my favorite Metallica album ever since, man.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Fucking awesome, man. Metallica. And let's talk about the cover, man, the album cover. How cool is it, man? The blue logo, the blue lightning, and just the electric chair and the logo. So badass, man.
Fucking iconic. And the like you said, the silver, the blue, the black. It's just so fucking just perfect. Icon. You know what I'm saying?
Dude, I've had multiple Ride the Lightning shirts. I actually have two of them right now. Two Ride the Lightning shirts. Same exact shirt. with that guy in the electric chair that glows in the dark on the back.
An amazing album, and I'm looking forward to getting into it. So why don't you get started? Seek and Destroy.
Man. All right. Track number one. Fight fire with fire. Fight fire with fire. Fight fire with fire. Fight fire with fire. Oh, my God, dude.
Yeah.
How freaking awesome is Fight Fire with Fire? Oh, my God, man. That little classical acoustic intro just builds in, and then it just fucking explodes into, like, at that time, probably the fastest guitar picking I've ever heard in my life at that time. I was just like, oh my God. I mean, this is the shit, man. And honestly, man, this is probably my favorite. It's my favorite Metallica song off the album, and probably my favorite Metallica song of all the time. It's just amazing, apocalyptic, heavy, fast as fuck. Just, you know, what more can you say about Fight? It's a fucking classic, dude.
It's amazing.
What's your thoughts on Fight Fire with Fire?
Yeah, Fight Fire. It almost screams Beavis and Butthead. Like, Fight Fire with Fire! Fight Fire with Fire!
It does, man.
It really does. For all you young people, Google Beavis and Butthead. Anyways, it's so violent. It's, you know, after such a, like you made reference to, after such a beautiful acoustic intro, then apocalyptic doom, and just so much violence in the song, and especially for back in 1984. And if I'm being honest, and I don't mean this in any sort of negative way, but I'm sure everything comes off the negative. This sound, James Hetfield, after recording, how old was James Hetfield when this album came out? He was 22, 21. He never sounded the same. Master of Puppets, he sounds very close, and just as, you know, close. But specifically in 1984, no, I guess he was 19. He was born in 63. Anyway, he never sounded the same. I mean,
no, man, he started to lose his baby voice.
Like, you know, you and me ripped the Kiss, the Scab Kiss fan. No, no matter what they put out, everything's great. You know, I'm kind of like, I'd be guilty of being a Metallica, Scab Kiss sort of equivalency. You know, even though I don't rate every album great, but I do like every album. So, you know, and I know there are people that say, what the fuck are you talking about? So, I don't know, dude. I think this song, James just never sounded the same. They just sounded the most violent. This band sounded the most violent and underground on this album, in my humble opinion.
Yeah, and guitars, man, their guitars had the best crunchy sound and distortion, man.
Yeah.
Oh my God, dude, it just, it's so crunchy, so nasty. I fucking love it, man. I love it, man.
Fucking okay, man. Hey, man, let's take a trip to the second song. A song called Ride the Lightning. Death in the air, strapped in the electric chair. You know, if I'm going to be real, if I'm going to be honest, man. I'm rating all our songs. So the first, Fight Fire with Fire, gets an A+. And then Ride the Lightning gets another A+. I think it's, I don't think it's probably, I'm sure it's my favorite song on this record.
Wow.
What a fucking 1-2. Holy shit. I mean,
oh, yeah. Oh.
The start of record, you know. You know what I'm saying? Usually it's spread out the best songs. In my humble opinion, the two best songs are bam, bam, right after another.
True, man. Fucking
sick, so apocalyptic, so just so of the time. You know, for young people that don't know, you know, this is, we did the Ozzy Ultimate Sin. Obviously, Ozzy is old enough to be these guys' dad. Probably close, at least. But just the mind frame of the mid-80s, the apocalyptic doom, the nuclear holocaust, and all the shit. It's just another brazen, it's a very, I don't know, man. They just took on subjects that really not, you know. I can't stop praising this album. And Ride the Lightning gets an A+. Sinking damn it.
Oh yeah, man! Ride the Lightning, the title track, man. Just love it, man. Just, oh man, just awesome. And got to give credit to Dave Mustaine. He contributed to this song at some point in time.
There's two songs on this album, right.
And you know, when you think about that, kind of like that opening riff, the Ride the Lightning riff, kind of does sound Dave Mustaine. Does sound like Mustaine's writing, so you know. But Ride the Lightning, man, what a badass song, you know. Getting strapped in the electric chair. If you notice, man, there's kind of a theme through this album. Every song is about, you know, some type of fear of some sort of death. You know, whether it's apocalyptic, getting
Fade
strapped
the black,
in the electric
fade,
chair,
very
suicide,
great.
Going to war, you know, being an escaped convict, running from the law, creeping death, man, having the fucking pharaohs coming to kill your firstborn son and shit, man. It's some fucking scary shit, man. It all deals with, you know, death in some form or another and the fear of it. So in my eyes, this is kind of like a semi-concept album in a way. Where they had
I don't think anybody would argue with you. I mean,
it's a concept album, but it had a theme. It had a theme to it.
Maybe not necessarily on the scale of a Operation Mind.
Oh, no. That's not what I'm talking about.
The whole story. But those songs have a connection and a basis, you know. So,
yeah.
I agree with that analogy.
Yeah, like the fear of death, you know, like, being fear for your life, you know, type thing. But, yeah, okay, man. Ride the Lightning. Awesome track. Let's move on to number 3, For Whom the Bell Tolls. Oh, my God, dude. What an incredible tune. I mean, at my age when this came out, up to a couple years later, this was the Metallica song that every guitar player and garage band would play, man. You'd get together and just be like, you know, you could usually find a drummer that could play that drum beat, and you know, the riff was simple, but it was just so heavy, man. I mean, nowadays the burnout factor is a little high on this tune, but it will forever be a classic, man, and a concert staple, man. For Whom the Bell Tolls, man, always gets the pits going, man. What do you think of For Whom the Bell Tolls, Wank?
I mean, you know, to say anything other than what you just said, as far as technically speaking, you're spot on, dude. And the interesting thing about this song is I have been in stadiums all around the country because I've never been out of the continental United States. Yankee Stadium, Fenway Park. I mean, this is a song that you hear in sporting events all around the country.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, oh, my God. Are you kidding me? Yeah. So I love that aspect. This, you know, sports, Boston sports in particular, is such an important part of my life. So when I'm at Foxborough Stadium back in the good old days when we were a dynasty, I remember hearing this song, you know, Patriots rally against Denver in January of 2012 when Brady had 5 touchdowns. Yeah, man, I just have really amazing personal memories about the song because it is a staple. It is a staple. It is like a metal song that mainstream culture has clinged on to and said, you know what? We accept this. You know, Metallica has been accepted by the main, which is, you know, some people hate on that. I don't hate on that. Just like when, like, new rock bands do good, I don't hate on them. I root for guitar-based music, you know what I'm saying? But, yeah, so this song is it's obviously simplistic. It's in the Am I Evil game sort of situation. It's brilliant, and I love it. Bam!
Hell yeah, man. Hell yeah. You want to take the next song first, Wayne?
Yeah. What the hell, man? Fade to Black, man. And you know what? Well, what are you chuckling about?
It's your turn, man. Go ahead.
Well, you're spitting a bit. You know what? Here's the deal. You know, I'm old enough. Remember, I got in this album. Let's see. It came out July 27th, so August, September, October, November. Probably 4 months after the record came out. That's when old Cubby turned me onto the record at Burger King in the drive-thru in the Scirocco. And back then they had 38-cent little burgers. And we got like 20 of them.
Chubby turns you on quite a bit.
Chubby is a classic legend, and I'd love to have him on the show, quite honestly.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. Oh, anyways, yeah. Man, so, Fade to Black, I mean, if you really think about it, I mean, if you really want to analyze this honestly, you know, Metallica was called a sellout from this juncture. But the first time Metallica was called a sellout was when they released the song.
Whatever.
The acousticness, the broadening of the sound. Metallica sold out. You know, so what do I think of the song? I think it's amazing and haunting and telling. I love it. Hey.
All right, man. Fade to Black, man. Let's be honest, man. It's a masterpiece. It's the first time they dabbled with a ballad. And, you know, a lot of people of our generation consider Metallica like our generation's Led Zeppelin.
Spot on.
And I would go to as far to say that Fade to Black is Metallica's Stairway to Heaven. Now, why do I say that? Because it starts off slow. It's got that you know, that melancholy, eerie intro with those guitar solos. Then it kind of picks up a little bit, brings it back down, and then it just just all out builds up, man, and explodes at the end, dude. It's just a masterpiece, man. And for anybody that's back in the day to call it a wimpy ballad or whatever, they weren't fucking listening to the whole song, because it's far from that, man. That man, when James rips into that riff, that I mean, holy shit, man. Strap it on, dude. You're in for the ride of your life, man. That was that's this song is I never get tired of it, dude. I never get tired of this song to this day.
Brother, you are tone on my heartstrings. I agree with every single analysis that you just said about the song, and I absolutely love the connection with Stairway to Heaven. Yeah. Fucking spot on. Yeah. It's something that obviously after you said it, I'm like, oh yeah, obviously. But I hadn't thought of that before. But I have said on numerous occasions throughout the years, Metallica is our generation, people in their 40s and 50s, Led Zeppelin.
Yeah, it's our Led Zeppelin, and a lot of people in media have called them that.
And I don't want to sell out younger people, but you know what I'm saying. Basically, you know, anyway. Yeah, it's amazing, dude. It's sick. And I give it an A, and I forgot to give you the grades. I give For Whom the Bell Tolls an A. I gave Ride the Lightning an A+. I gave Fight Fire with Fire an A+. And now we're going under ice.
Trapped under ice.
Yeah, we're going under ice, and we're going to see what Sinkin' Stanley thinks about being trapped under ice.
Bam. Oh, man, that'd be scary as fuck, bro. See what I'm talking about, man? Another, you know, being trapped under ice, man. You're afraid of dying. You're afraid of drowning. Every song is about being afraid of something.
And if you think about it, if you're trapped under ice and you have clearness of the water, you see the blue sky in the New England winter where the ice is fucking frozen, but you're trapped under ice, so you can text. Yeah, it's a phenomenal song. Go ahead, my brother.
Phenomenal song, man. It's my second favorite song on the album. I love this song so much, man, Trapped Under Ice. And I just got to say, man, if y'all never heard the Death Angel version of this, Death Angel do a killer, killer version of this. And who are Death Angel? Well, at this time, Kurt Hammett produced Death Angel's first demo. Yeah, right around the time of Ride the Lightning. They were all from the Bay Area. Death Angel.
Oh, man, I'm well aware, but I don't see a Death Angel big fan. You know, but do I hate him? Hell no.
Death Angel. Death Angel rules, man.
And the lead singer is now in the Kerry King band.
Yes, he is. But yeah, man.
I will look into that song. Sinkin' Stanley.
Awesome, Wang. What do you think of Trapped Under Ice?
Oh, my goodness gracious, man. I mean, it's basically riffage from fucking hell. I mean, apocalyptic doom. Somebody's going to die, and possibly a lot of people are going to die. I mean, just the whole, like you said, not to piggyback too much, but just the whole album about death and destruction and conquering and suicide. It was just... I fucking absolutely adore this song, and I give this song... I mean, the energy level itself is 10, man. I mean, there's just so much energy, so much Fleming Rasmussen, man. That's my nigga, dude. I mean, with all due respect, bro, I love that motherfucker. But Rivers from Hell, energy level at 10. I give this song an A.
Hell yeah. Hell yeah, man. All right, you want to take the next song, Wang?
Yeah, man, that's interesting. I mean, it's obviously the bastard child of the album. Yeah. You know, and reading, you know, things throughout the last 40 years, it was a song that they tried, basically invented, as it were, produced, like, on the spot, like, late because they needed time or whatever. You know what? I understand the reluctancy of the Metallica fan Cam analysis, fans and everything, this is music. No, it is obviously the worst song on the record. It's not, it doesn't have too much invention. It's sort of, I don't know, man. It doesn't suck. Don't get me wrong.
No, it don't suck.
Yeah, the instrumentation alone brings it above a B. But I'm going to say B minus, Ben.
All right, man. Escape. Yeah, man. James hates it. I happen to love it, man. Is it the best song on the album? No, I would say it's the weakest song on the album. They took a left turn with this one, obviously. But man, in the context of the entire album, yeah, man, I don't skip it. I love it, man. I like it. Yeah.
It's definitely the Bastard Child.
Oh, yeah, it's definitely. If there was a weakest song on the album, this would be it.
Yeah.
Yep,
yeah.
Definitely. Definitely.
All right, all good.
Yeah.
I love it.
I said
B minus.
So. Yeah, B minus. All right, yeah. Number seven, moving on to Creeping Death. Oh, my God, man. What an awesome biblical tale. I mean, this was a single. This was the only single off the album. Isn't that weird? Isn't that weird?
Right, and the single was released, and we're going to touch on this.
We're going to discuss that. We're going to discuss that at the end. We won't talk about that now, but we are going to discuss this Creeping Death EP.
Yes, sir.
There's a couple.
Bam!
There we go, man. But Creeping Death, man, what a monstrous song. Played in concert till this day. Yeah, man. Just love it, man. It gets the crowd going. Awesome song. Wang, what's your thoughts on Creeping Death?
All-time metal classic, fabulous and brutal, and I give it an A.
Hell yeah, man. Hell yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely. And Wang, what's your thoughts on the closing song on this album, this masterpiece of an album?
Oh, I love this shit. I love the complex, crazy kids writing complex, crazy music, epic. I give it an A. I think this album is, if not, one of the top five heavy metal albums to ever exist.
No, we're talking about the last song of the album.
No, I understand that, homeboy, and I told you about that. The Call of Cthulhu.
Yes.
And leading up to my analysis of the song, I was trying to paint a picture, but Sink and Stanley prevented me from saying that.
Oh, man. Yeah,
I accept your apology. But, you talk
Total
about...
cock block.
Hey, man, cock block. Vinny Vincent has issues with you. And we're going to get into that later. Mark St. John's sister will be... Yeah.
You save all that for the Kiss episode.
Yeah, and next week... And hold on, people. Next week, we are... Next week or next episode, whenever that is. Maybe next week, whenever. It probably, who knows? We're going to do Kiss Unmasked. So I got some Vinny Vincent and Mark St. John sister news. So that goes with it. But yeah, like I said, when I said this, love this shit, complex, crazy kids writing complex, crazy music. Epic. The fucking amazing instrumental. And I fucking adore it. Hey, bam!
Yeah, man, the Call of Cthulhu, excellent, excellent ending to the album. Great instrumental, you know, heavy as fuck. You know, got to give credit to Mustaine. He had some writing credit for this song. I don't know what he contributed to this song, but obviously it worked because it's a great instrumental, and it closes this masterpiece of an album, man.
Yeah.
So that's it. That's it for Ride the Lightning, the album. But we are not done, man. We are not done. We are gonna include the Creeping Death EP single. Creeping Death with the two bonus songs, Am I Evil and Blitzkrieg. So let's get right into it, Wang. Wang, what's your thoughts on Am I Evil, man? They're two cover songs. Metallica did them their own way. What do you think of Am I Evil?
What do I think of Am I Evil? First of all, obviously it's a Diamond Head cover. It's a fun song. It's obviously rather simplistic compared to the complexity of Metallica of that era. I think it's, I mean, it's a great song. I love Blitzkrieg way more. The next song that we're going to talk about. But I think, you know, it's amazing. And Metallica put put a lot of money in Diamond Head's pockets. And
yes, they did.
Yeah, big time.
And thank you very much.
Yeah, and just for a statistic thing, I guess the last time this album was certified by RIAA was in 2012, and it was at 6.95 million sales. So there's going to be time in our life, probably within the next 5 years. And Justice for All is at 9.5 million. I know a lot of bands don't do this, but Metallica is smart enough to do this. I know they got to be. There could be, obviously, the Black Album is the number one album of the SoundScan era. That's a fact. Number one album of the SoundScan era of all genres is Metallica, the Black Album. And Justice for All is about to hit a diamond. And Jesus Christ, man, if this is at 6.9 million back in 2012, wonder what it is now. You know what I'm saying?
I don't know, man. I don't keep track of that stuff like you do.
Yeah, I do. I find it fascinating, man.
Yeah, it is. It is. It is.
It really is. It really is. And you know, and the cool thing about this band is, even though you and me are 5 years apart, we both got into them in the early days. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That matters.
Yeah.
That matters. You have, you know, if you jumped on during the Load, and you know, I've done podcasts that I've supported the Load episode and the Reload episode. You know what I'm saying? I like that shit. You know, I don't know how you're taking on there, but that's for another day or whatever.
Yeah.
But I've been a Metallica fan since Chubby said in my Volkswagen Scirocco at Burger King, buying Burger King single burgers. I believe it's like 48 cents. We bought 20 of them. Put this cassette in that blow pump.
And just Bill blew your mind.
I went, I mean, like I said, not to repeat myself. Whoa. This is like very violent. Very violent, almost, just almost no melody to it.
Yeah.
And then as the years went on, there's, you know, you got snippets of melody, but that initial reaction as a teenager, oh, I was just like, holy shit, Chubby, what the fuck?
It made you bang your head and tap your foot, man. You couldn't keep still listening to this stuff.
Oh, you know? For sure. And then you being 5 years younger, I find it amazing that you found this, but, you know, whatever.
Yeah. 83, dude. I was, what, 83?
No, 84. This came out July 27th,
No, I'm talking about when I discovered it was 83.
Oh, okay.
Was the Whiplash EP, so, yeah, I was, I was 12 years old.
Yeah, crazy. But I got
12
into
or 13, 12,
so, all right, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But Am I Evil, man? Am I Evil? Oh, my God, what a great Diamond Head cover. Oh, my God, Metallica basically made it their own.
Yeah.
They totally, like you said, totally. See, that's why Metallica's so cool. They'll take something, make it their own, but they always give back. They gave back to Diamond Head. I mean, I don't think many people in America would know who Diamondback was if it wasn't for Metallica.
Fucking spot on!
You
Are
know?
You kidding?
Yeah. Fuck the guitar player from Diamond Head just got a gig with another big band. Who's he playing with now?
I don't know, but all I know is you said double. I wouldn't know who fucking. I mean, eventually.
Exactly.
No, but eventually, I guess I would have. But back then, I had no clue who the fuck Diamond Head was.
Exactly.
You know, I wasn't into that. You know, I mean, all these Johnny come lately, this revisionist historian. Oh, I was there. Oh yeah. I heard all this. Yeah, most of them are full of shit.
Bullshit, man. I had no idea who the fuck Diamond Head was.
Yeah, and why they're full of shit. Because these albums didn't sell shit. No, not Metallica, but 99.9% of the quote-unquote new wave of British heavy metal bands sold nothing.
And then they did another Diamond Head cover, Helpless Man. What another badass thing.
Oh, yeah. I love that EP.
Oh, dude, yeah. We'll have to review that sometime. Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, the first Jason Newsted shit, dude. Oh.
Yeah.
Love that shit. 1987. For sure.
All right. But anyway, let's get to the last song, the second cover on the Creeping Death EP. Blitzkrieg. Oh my God, Blitzkrieg. Oh God, dude. This song just kicks you right in the nuts, man. This song, man, such a badass song. So heavy, so awesome. I mean, they didn't even really stray much from the original tune. I mean, if you listen to Blitzkrieg, the name of the band, and the song, you know, their song Blitzkrieg, I mean, Metallica play it note for note, man. They just make it more heavy, man. They just metallicize it, man. And it's freaking awesome, man. Wang, what do you think of Blitzkrieg?
Oh, man, I have nothing to add. It's brilliant. And it's so cool. It's the name of the band. I fucking adore the song. And these two songs appeared on the Kill 'Em All, expanded edition, right?
Yes. Yep. Every time released, like they did the cassette version of Kill 'Em All. They slap these songs on there. So yeah, that's cool, man.
Hell yeah, man. So
more money in Diamond Head and Blitzkrieg's pocket, man. That they
fucking A, brother. Like, they are going cha-ching.
They're
the homeboy, what's the guy? Is it Tyler? What's the lead singer of Diamond Head?
No, that's the guitar player. Is Tatler. The guitar player is
Tatler. That's the leader of the band?
Yeah, he's the leader of the band,
He's been on documented saying that Metallica put, I believe, like one of his children to college or something.
Oh, yeah. Metallica probably paid for his house, paid for everything.
Yeah, man, like you said, man, all the haters hate on Metallica because here's the deal. Everybody hates on the best.
Oh, yeah.
Everybody hates on the best.
I mean, don't get me wrong, man. Don't get me wrong. Do I love everything Metallica's done? No. No, I don't. No, I don't. But, you know, I appreciate what they do. I appreciate what they try to do. And like I said, man, they're great guys. They always give back. They're loyal as fuck. You know, man, you can't say more about Metallica, man. And they take care of their fans. They take care of their fans. They don't price gouge them, as far as I know.
No, you're right.
They try to give them the best deals they can, you know.
So, I've been with them 40 years and... And probably, I would say, around Thanksgiving of 1984, I had that moment with Chubby.
Yeah.
At the Burger King with the 48-cent burgers.
Hell yeah.
Yeah.
Well, man, that's about wraps it up, man, for this Metallica Ride the Lightning episode. You got anything else you want to add, Wang?
No, man. Awesome, fun times. And the next episode will be... We are returning to KISS.
Oh, my God. KISS. Yes.
Yes. We are returning to KISS. Unmasked will be the next episode. Hopefully it'll be...
The KISS stars rejoice.
What's that?
The KISS stars rejoice.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know. So we're going to go from episodes that bomb to episodes that do great.
Oh, yeah, man. Thank you, KISS stars, for listening to us. We appreciate
it. Right on, man.
And join the Sinking Wag Facebook group.
Oh, my goodness gracious. Oh, my goodness gracious. I have nothing to say about the Sinking Wag Facebook group.
Yes, join the Sinking Wag Facebook group, goddammit. Yeah.
For sure.
All
for
right,
sure,
man. Sure. All right, Wang, if you ain't got anything else to say, right?
Right.
Well, that continues another episode of the Sinking Wang Show. We'll see you next time.
This has been a Fake Arnie production.
Bam!